Brighton-born and bred historian Chris Horlock knows the city like the back of his hand. Who knew that the small stretch between the two piers on Brighton's seafront has so much history?
Chris, here we are on the pier.
Indeed, and a bit of a blowy day, and the weather's not too good, but yeah.
Mustn't grumble.
No, we mustn't, indeed.
Do you know what? When I have guests or take friends down to the seafront, it's nearly always either to the pier or to the bit between the two piers, this one and the west.
That's what I call the lower promenade. That's what I'll call it as we talk.
Fine, but I understand that this part, the eastern part of the Brighton Palace Pier, is, or at least was, very popular, very interesting, had a rich history. It's kind of less popular these days, isn't it? I mean, I kind of mainly go there if I look for parking.
If you can find it, yes.
If I can find it, getting harder and harder. Yeah. But I mean, there is some incredible architecture there, the arches.
There is, and whenever I'm looking this way, and it has never really been hugely popular with visitors because there are few amenities, but whenever I'm here I see terrific building, an unrivaled set of seafront buildings architecturally, and terrific engineering achievements. And the one that the wow factor for me is always this sea wall that is running all the way along there, virtually from, well, it is actually holding up Marine Parade.
Literally.
It was all bare cliff there once, if you can imagine, going right back, as it was in fact along the whole seafront of Brighton. But that wall was built, it took quite a long time to build. It was built by a man called William Lambert. It took about 10 years to build. It was built in sections and it was finished in 1838. And it is 23 feet thick at the bottom, which is incredible.
It is very thick.
And at its highest point, I think it's 60 feet, something like that. It was 1838 it was finished. 1823, the Chain Pier, and everyone says, where was the Chain Pier?
Where was the Chain Pier?
Well, that was already in place, and it came off the bottom of New Steam.
Right.
It wasn't terribly long. And in fact, the Chain Pier was more of a jetty.
So why was it called a Chain Pier? Because it was literally chained to the...
Well, if you look at some early drawings of how it was going to be, it was just a quay. It was just a walkway like you get in a harbour. But remember, 1823, the Royal Pavilion is finished that year, more or less. So, well, we better do something fairly elegant.
Right.
The King is in town. He's living at the Pavilion. Longer than people think. So they made this rather elegant, still functional pier, and that was for big ships to and from the continent. A lot of wealthy people staying at the Pavilion wanted to get abroad, wanted to carry on their visit, London, Brighton,
right,
to the continent, Paris perhaps, and it's one of the great sights of southern Britain.
So people walked on the pier in order to then embark onto a...
You went to the end where there were sort of waiting areas. They were open really to the elements. And you caught your steamer there, wherever you wanted to go.
No entertainment and
on the pier? Well, a band played occasionally, and there were a few knick-knacks to buy and things, but generally, no, it was a functional jetty.
I see.
We have to wait till the West Pier before we get a promenade deck and... you know,
but
that
then it
sort of
collapsed,
thing.
Right? There was a huge storm and it disappeared.
It lasted from 1823 to 1896. Huge storm blew it away. Wood everywhere. The damage wrecked the Palace Pier, which was being built. It wrecked the West Pier. It wrecked Volks Railway, which incidentally is 1883. And there were damage claims, and that's why the Palace Pier took so long to build, because they owned the Chain Pier, and the damage claims were against the Palace Pier Company.
Are there any leftovers? Oh, I was just about to ask, are there any leftovers?
That's a little bit of the Chain Pier.
Chain Pier, Brighton. Where do you have that from?
Well, they made all sorts of souvenirs. I've seen walking sticks, picture frames, pin cushions. And you'd think it would be good old English oak, but it's not. It's Norwegian fir, which apparently was a very sappy wood, and it is still a bit. You feel that. It's a bit sticky, which was meant to repel the water. But just going back to the seafront here, talking about engineering, we've got the arches, which are in very poor condition at the moment. The first bit of that.
But the fact that they've survived in relatively, I mean, the Victorians were better builders than we are today, no?
Well, indeed, and they were built to last, and the whole thing was finished in 1897. So it took 7 years to build that string of arches. And see, it's engineering. I look at it and I think, well, that's unique. I don't think any other town, city, certainly not a seaside resort, has got that string of arches. And then coming up to date, you've got the marina. Again, that was as audacious as the Chain Pier in its day, because that marina there at Black Rock, there's no natural harbour. The coastline doesn't dip in nicely.
Right.
It's built in the open sea. And those of us that were here in Brighton, and the fuss getting it built, I think it took 12 years from the initial ideas in the 60s through to 1979 when it was opened by the Queen. We even had a poll. Things came through our door. Do you want a marina? And we voted on it, a kind of referendum,
right,
which was very new and novel.
So clearly most people did want a marina.
Yeah, we all, those of us, because I just lived in White Street there, I was born and brought up in Brighton, we all came down to see it being built, bit by bit by bit. The original plan, there were over 50 buildings and amenities going to be built on it, including hotels and a dolphinarium, which ended up at the aquarium, theatre, I think, tennis court, sports facilities, ice rink.
So what happened?
But the money ran out.
Right.
And when it opened, there wasn't a single building on it.
But going right back, Whitehawk has a historical significance.
Well, it does. Whitehawk, I can just see the hill from here. That's where the first Brightonian people settled.
And when you say first Brightonians, you mean?
Ancient man. I think it's the New Stone Age. 5,500 years ago, 5,000 to 5,500 years ago. So that is actually older, that site, than Stonehenge.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
So we need is to stick a piece of rock or something and start worshipping it.
Who knows what was up there? It hasn't been extensively excavated. 30s they did some, one or two others. And what they found is in Brighton Museum. But my memory, I have a bizarre memory in the 60s of women in stilettos, the great phase, coming along the pier and suddenly lurching as the heel went down the crack. And often they couldn't get it out and you'd find stiletto heel, you know, and sometimes the odd shoe. That's a memory of, you know, early 60s fashion.
Well, luckily we're very fashionable today, you and I, but sensible shoes. So how about walking to the other side of the pier?
Yeah, and we'll carry on the story there, sure. Brighton has had over 40 names in its history. Brighton was officially adopted 1810.
I thought it was Brighthelm before.
Well, that was before that. Brighthelmston, with or without an E. Yeah, yes.
And was it really fashionable here? I mean, the promenade, the seafront.
Well, there was no proper road here until really the 1820s, when the king put some money on the table and the first part of King's Road was opened in 1822, I think, somewhere then, but only a little bit of it. It was a rough track, and it wasn't called South Street either.
Right.
There was no South Street. The one that's there today is more modern. But of course, the beach is now going to be the town's prosperity as we go through time.
Shall we go down there and have some prosperity?
Yeah.
So we're outside the Brighton Fishing Museum.
We are.
And the smell of fish from over there.
Yeah.
It's so wonderful. I know what I'm going to do when we stop filming today.
Redolent of fish and chips and sausage and mash in the past. Yes, we are outside the Fishing Museum, which is a fairly recent addition to the seafront in all these arches.
But the original one was
the fish market
was
further along, yes, further which is
along.
Now.
Okay, so you mentioned
Dipping and bathing. Well, that's the next part of the story, really, of the seafront. In the early 1700s, when Brighton had been devastated and was rebuilding itself after those storms, we get this health fad suddenly amongst the wealthy. They were a pretty unhealthy lot, you know. They had all sorts of ailments that would be readily cured now or treated. But then, medicine was still hit and miss. Anyway, they had all sorts of... The word went round that sea bathing was a kind of cure-all.
Was that Dr. Russell?
Russell was interesting because he said drink the stuff as well.
Oh.
He said if you drink a pint a day,
no.
it will whiten the teeth, clear the head. and produce three or four good, sharp, short stools. I'm quoting from his dissertation. And then it was a purifier to some extent, and it must have worked because it caught on. And so what you get now is...
So people actually drank a pint of seawater a day.
Yeah, for medicinal purposes. And they ate all sorts of seawater things like crab's eyes and, water thing, seaweed and that.
I mean, we do today.
We do, indeed. So there was...
I don't know how healthy they are.
Well, I think the dipping and the bathing, there's iodine in the water, which, and particularly skin, and it was just a good wash, basically, which many of them didn't have. Anyway, this caught on, so soon you have stagecoach loads of people coming to Brighton, wanting accommodation, so the town starts to build. Dice of circumstance really roll in Brighton's favour, because as things are picking up due to medicine and health, the heir to the throne of England, Prince of Wales, who's going to become George IV, makes his first visit to Brighton. And when he comes, everybody follows.
Why did he choose Brighton, and why did Brighton become origin of this notion of healthy swimming or drinking?
Well, firstly, because it is healthy to breathe in good sea air.
But there are so many other towns.
Brighton isn't alone in this. As Brighton developed, Worthing developed too, and there were other places all along the south coast benefiting from this. Even Blackpool starts dipping and bathing and so on. But the Prince came, he was actually visiting a very interesting man, the Duke of Cumberland, his uncle. Who is worth a talk in himself. He was such a rogue, and his wife was even worse. They are a great... And he took the seawater cure when he had swellings of the neck. That's why he wore those cravats, they say, because he had huge swellings. Well, they caught on. Everyone was wearing those fashionable cravats. So he liked Brighton. It was raffish. It was away from the stiffness of court. He could do what he liked. He was out of his father's eye, George III. And there was plenty of fun and games down this end of the country for him to indulge in. So, yeah. And he patronised the town, built his pavilion, the Marine Pavilion first, which was a sort of smaller version, and finally the Royal Pavilion. And he visited Brighton quite a lot, much more than people think. And the town really has built on that prosperity ever since. What's the key tourist attraction? Well, two, the Palace Pier and the Pavilion.
So obviously Brighton did then start and became a kind of a centre for pleasures and entertainment.
Indeed.
I wanted to ask you about this very obscure and very curious kind of structures that were operating on the sea, the Daddy Long Legs.
That's not here. That's further east. That was an invention by Magnus Volk.
Of
Volk's Railway. Yeah, 1896, this was a very strange, almost H.G. Wells type War of the Worlds thing, which was a tram car virtually on legs that moved through the sea and took you from the Banjo Groin to Rottingdean and back.
Quite a few people could sit on it.
Yes, it held the pictures we've got of it, it's always crowded, but it didn't last long. 1896 is the year the Chain Pier was blown away and it was damaged. He repaired it. But then 1901, there are problems with the groins in that area. The council want to lengthen them, and it would meant diverting his line further out to sea, which was impractical, too much, and so it was abandoned. But it was a real curiosity of Brighton.
I reckon there's scope for a new one, a renewed Daddy Long Legs.
Well,
the I-360 to the marina.
It's the same kind of technology, Magnus Volk was a great pioneer. Electricity, he lit his home with electricity, and very interesting man.
So we just walked along we did the posh people's walk, right?
Along the lower promenade, I call it the lower promenade.
Promenade, but that was a walk that people kind of took to the West Pier when that was built?
I would have thought they walked along King's Road, because by the time the West Pier is built, 1866, it opens in 1866, you've got a proper King's Road.
Okay.
But not down here so much.
This was that still very rough?
Yeah, it was still a bit rough and ready. It's only when these red brick arches are all installed that things pick up. You know, it took the Victorians to tidy it all up and make a big amenity of it.
So that was really kind of regenerating the area to cater for visitors, for tourism.
Yes, yes, indeed. When the West Pier opened, 1866, it was still just a gravel path. So something had to happen here. Now, it's interesting because when that is built, it's not a commercial venture, really.
Unlike the Palace Pier.
Well, that's coming later. That is commercial from day one. The West Pier was basically a good walk, the health thing again, over the briny, out to sea. The world is behind your shoulder.
You've got,
you know, it's refreshing. It's cathartic. You know, it was just this promenade pier for many, many years, until you get a concert hall. Well, it's extended a bit in the middle in the 1870s. You get a concert hall built at the end in the 1890s, 1893. But that's when the Palace Pier is being built.
Rivalry,
indeed. So when the Palace Pier is built, a theatre is part of the plan. And in fact, the original name for the Palace Pier was the Brighton Marine Palace and Pier. So the Marine Palace was the theatre on the end.
And Pier is a separate entity.
Indeed. So when they opened the Palace Pier in 1899, in May, the ceremony was done. They all walked to the end and put in the first pile for the theatre. And it was a theatre, not a concert hall. The West Pier, they've got a theatre. We've only got a concert hall. They changed the concert hall to a theatre in the early 1900s.
So there were two theatres, so close to each other. Different shows.
In fact, the West Pier was a bit classier. You did get a bit of Shakespeare there. On the Palace Pier, commercial, fun and games, silly farces and so on. But of course, the West Pier is, where do you start telling the story of its demise? It closed half of it, and I can remember it very well, half of it closed in 1970. The seaward end was shut off. Neglect, no investment, rot. The people that owned it weren't spending money on it.
So they closed it kind of in the middle, halfway, so people could still walk to
that. You could still get into the bingo hall, which was the winter garden orchestral place. Then 1975, it was finally closed, and you get that huge, protracted, tedious saga of trying to save the West Pier. It all came to tears early 2000s when it was burnt down several times, and that is what is left. And people say it's iconic and photographic and preserve it. I think it's a reproach, because I remember the West Pier very, very well, and I'm still amazed how somehow it just slipped away. So in terms of piers, we have the Chain Pier, the West Pier, and the Palace Pier. So three piers. So was there any time people wonder where all three piers were standing? Did Brighton ever have three piers? And
did
the answer is yes, because we have photos of the West Pier, the ailing Chain Pier teetering over on its last legs, and the Palace Pier being built to replace it. Not on the same site, at the end of the steam where it goes out.
So people were spoiled for piers.
So the Chain Pier was actually shut down in 1896, but it stood there for a while. Blown away that year, of course.
Right.
So we're down to two piers, and now we have one. Let's go over there.
So here we are again. We've walked all the way to the West Pier and back.
Yep.
But you mentioned the theatre on this pier.
Yeah.
It's
not
that long ago that it was still operating.
It opened in 1901, and as I said, it was to keep people on the pier, really, and an all-weather attraction. So the plays were fun and games. And by the time you get into the post-war period, you get Doctor in the House, Agatha Christie, that sort of thing, and summer variety.
Mm.
When the Hippodrome closes in 64, we get summer variety full-blown starting here. But when the Noble organisation took over, They demolished the theatre, 1986.
Was that a wise decision from a business point of view?
Well, the promise was that they would rebuild it, but they never did. They built the Pleasure Dome, and that's still there. And now, of course, we've got new owners. One thing I must mention before we finish is just the range of entertainment in the area we've just walked through in the past. It's busy now, and there are buskers and so on, but late 1800s, early 1900s, you'd have a job getting through all the entertainers that were down there. And we've got some fabulous photos of strongmen, acrobats, singers, ventriloquists.
So much more than that. Because we think of Brighton and this hub of this lively art, culture, entertainment.
People think it's lively now. It's nothing to how it used to be. And of course, 1840s, you get the trains arriving and you get an influx of working class people, posh people too, but working class people, and that leads to another boom in Brighton's prosperity, but more aimed at them.
Right.
We get our first music hall in Brighton in the 1860s.
Which one was that?
That was in New Road, very near the Theatre Royal,
right.
And they didn't like it. They wanted a lovely, pleasurable walk, so we get the West Pier. Want to walk in the wet weather, we get the arches here that are falling down. They want piers, they want entertainment, they want food.
Chris, thank you so much for this enlightening tour.
Been a pleasure.
And I really look forward to exploring some other parts of Brighton. And
perhaps some things you don't know about next time.
Perhaps,
you know, because
know.
A lot of this people do know, you know, the piers, particularly the West Pier. But we can go into the interior and look there at whatever we need to look at.
I look forward to that.
Good, thank you.